My name is Tamara Weider. I'm the Public Affairs and Policy Director for Planned Parenthood Advocates of Indiana and Kentucky. I stand here renewed in our fight for reproductive access in the Commonwealth. The last 4 years, we have seen some of the most hostile and directed attacks on reproductive autonomy and Planned Parenthood that I have ever witnessed. Amid all the attacks, Kentuckians are coming out stronger than ever in their support for increased access to reproductive care, including abortion. In fact, back in June, we did polling across the state that further speaks to our mission and our fight here in the General Assembly. 65% of Kentuckians, let me repeat, 65% of Kentuckians say that they would have doubts about a law that bans abortion, especially in cases of rape or incest. We also found that nearly 90% of Kentuckians support comprehensive sex education and birth control. As you will see today from our speakers, we are not only ready to defend our constitutional access to all these basic human rights, we are going on the offense, working to see the passage of bills that will support our incredible state. Coming out of the harrowing 2019 legislative session, extremist politicians in the legislature are continuing their efforts to ban abortion in the Commonwealth. Representative Belcher's HB 142 is a state-level gag rule that will impact all state funding recipients from talking about abortion. Representative Fisher's House Bill 67 would amend the Kentucky Constitution to prohibit any protections or funding for safe, legal abortion. As I mentioned earlier, these bans are unpopular among the majority of people in our Commonwealth, something our legislators need to take note of. We know there is a lot of work that we will need to do. We have proven we are up to this task. We had our first on-the-ground electoral campaign in 2019, and we sent anti-abortion Matt Bevin packing. We have a new year ahead of us and new data that supports a mighty group ready to rise up for reproductive freedom. We are here for you. We won't back down. We are Planned Parenthood, and we are ready for the 2020 legislative session. So with that, let me introduce our first speaker, Representative Attica Scott.
Thank you so much for Planned Parenthood and its leadership in Kentucky and Indiana. We need it every single day. So I wanted to speak today about Maternal Care Act that I filed last week in partnership with Rep. Wiederstein of Davis County and part of Henderson County. And we are both committed to babies and healthy pregnancies, and we have a growing list of co-sponsors with us on the bill. We know that the United States is among the world's wealthiest countries, but we also know that it has the highest rate of maternal mortality. And sadly, people of color are three times more likely to die from complications during or soon after pregnancy than their white peers. Often we hear about integrity in government. If my colleagues have integrity on both sides of the aisle while they're trying to abolish abortion, they would do all that they can to make sure that people have healthy pregnancies and healthy babies. Nearly four times the number of pregnant black people compared to their white peers die from complications from pregnancy. And can you believe that the maternal mortality rate in the United States rose 26% from 2010 through 2014, 26%. And that is why it matters that Planned Parenthood of Indiana and Kentucky and the American Civil Liberties Union of Kentucky have joined together with us to make sure that the legislature steps up to address implicit bias in healthcare, to address racial bias in medicine, and to increase access to doulas who support pregnant patients. Now in Kentucky, the maternal mortality rate is 22.9 deaths per 100,000 births. Shouldn't every person in Kentucky be entitled to dignity and respect during and after their pregnancy? I would think so, and I would think that the entire legislature would agree. And that dignity and respect should extend to you regardless of your age, citizenship status, disability, first language, nationality, race, religion, sexual orientation, or socioeconomic status. We have a responsibility in Kentucky to decrease the number of preventable maternal deaths. We can do this by making sure that our implicit bias programs help providers to identify unconscious bias, cultural and structural barriers to inclusion, corrective measures to decrease implicit bias, understanding of cultural trauma and racism, discussion of the impact of power dynamics and organizational decision-making on implicit bias, a discussion of health inequities within the perinatal field, and information on reproductive justice, including how your economic status, how environmental justice, toxic lead exposure, immigration status, mental health, transportation, and all of these issues impact reproductive health. So I imagine that most people across Kentucky care about the health of moms and their babies. So I look forward to joining with folks across Kentucky to move the legislature to support the Maternal Care Act. So that's one piece of legislation that I wanted to share today, but I also wanted to share that I'm speaking with Planned Parenthood about how we improve access to birth control for all Kentuckians. I know how difficult it is to have to get to the pharmacy every month for prescriptions to be refilled, and I can only imagine what it's like for people who have access to transportation issues or barriers with working full-time or childcare. And so we're in conversations about making sure that pharmacies are able to provide 12-month supplies of birth control to people who use birth control. And so we're in continued conversations about that, and we'll have more to share later in the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Representative Scott. I'm now going to call forward Representative Lisa Wilmer.
Thank you, Tamari, and thank you, Planned Parenthood. I'm here to talk with you this morning about comprehensive sexuality education. It's an issue that I advocated for strongly when I served on the Jefferson County Board of Education, and now that I'm serving in the legislature, I'm going to continue my advocacy for comprehensive sexuality education for all public school students. So here in Kentucky, we call ourselves a pro-life state, but the health data and the outcomes for our young people tells a very different story about how we value life, how we value the quality of life, and how we value the health of the lives of our young people. Not only in Kentucky do we have 1 in 5 children living in poverty, but Kentucky has among the very highest rates in the country for unintended pregnancies among adolescent girls ages 14 to 19. Here in Kentucky, we have among the very highest rates of childbirth among adolescent girls ages 14 to 19. Our statistics are far above the national average for teen sexual dating violence, for teen physical dating violence. Here in Kentucky, young people, both boys and girls, are physically forced to have sex against their wills at higher than the national average. If we truly value the lives of our young people, we need to address this, and that's why we need, here in Kentucky, a comprehensive sex education bill for all public schools, K through 12. That's why we need comprehensive sex ed. Comprehensive sex ed is truly the most pro-life legislation we could propose. It ought to have strong bipartisan support, and we already know that it has very strong public support. I want to be really clear about what comprehensive sexuality education is: medically accurate, age-appropriate, inclusive, comprehensive sex ed is not just about sex. Comprehensive sex ed provides social and emotional tools for safe and healthy relationships, not just with partners or potential partners or future partners, but with family, with friends, with teachers, with people, everyone they go to school with. Comprehensive sexuality education provides social and emotional tools for healthy decision making. Comprehensive sexuality education provides social and emotional tools for respect for one's own bodies, respect for other people's bodies, for the choices that people make and articulate about their bodies, for consent, for understanding what consent is, how to give consent, how to respect other people's consent or failure to give consent. All of this is built into comprehensive sexuality education. recognizing and avoiding risk-taking behaviors. That's something that every parent wants. It's a nonpartisan issue. It's not an urban versus rural issue. Every parent in the state of Kentucky wants their children to be able to recognize risks when they see it and to have the social and emotional tools to be able to make decisions to avoid those risks. So this bill that we will be filing in the coming days is a public health initiative. It's a psychological and mental health initiative. It's a physical health initiative, and it's for the good of all the folks in the Commonwealth. I look forward to the strong bipartisan support that we're going to get on this very pro-life, comprehensive sexuality education bill. Thank you very much.
All right, and then we're going to bring up Representative Charles Booker.
Good morning, and thank you. I first want to thank and commend the leadership of Planned Parenthood for your tireless efforts to help protect our families and make sure that all women have the right of agency over reproductive health and ensure justice for all Kentuckians. That is why I'm here today, not simply as a legislator, but as a father, as a son, as a human being. Understanding that if we want to have a gainful future for our Commonwealth, it means that we need to be standing for justice, standing for access, and protecting the rights of women to be able to make decisions for their own bodies, and also understand our responsibility to protect and defend children all the way through the life process, which means comprehensive sex education so that they have the tools they need to make informed decisions, protect themselves, and be healthy. This is not a conversation about partisan divides. It is a conversation about how we stand together and defend the people that we love, our sisters and brothers all across the Commonwealth. And this is a moment that requires us to not only be on the defensive. We know that there were a lot of harmful pieces of legislation that were put forth in the past session. We have a job to raise the standard and to oppose those bills that are going to threaten the voices, the agency of women, threaten reproductive health, threaten reproductive justice, but we also have the responsibility to be on the offensive and say, how do we build a better future for our families? That's what this work is about. And so I commend Planned Parenthood. I'm honored to stand with you in the effort to, again, put politics aside and understand that we have a responsibility to those all over the Commonwealth, regardless of how much money you have in your pocket or your socioeconomic status, but knowing that you have value. And I hope that people all over the Commonwealth take heed and understand that we're here to stand together. We're here to lock arms and to defend the very future that we all deserve. So thank you again and honored to be a part.
Thank you. It's so wonderful to come to Frankfort and know that we have incredible champions fighting for us every day here, both in the House and the Senate. But it's also important to know that we have voices throughout the Commonwealth who stand with us. And so here today, we have various voices who will be speaking to the specific legislation and fights that we have ahead. I'm going to bring up Ashley Van Schindel as our first speaker.
Hello, and thank you so much, Tamari. Abortion access is something that's important to me because autonomy over my body is an essential right that needs to be protected for all. Legislative restrictions have real consequences for people who need access to this care. Had I been subject to the waiting periods in other states, it is possible that I could have died from my ectopic pregnancy. In addition to giving me the life that I want to live, abortion kept me alive, and for that, I am supportive of clear, unrestricted access to all who need it. I was 20 years old. I had been studying biology and working on my creative writing assignment. For several days, I felt nauseated and had a mild pain in my abdomen. I didn't think much of it. It was likely something that I ate. I'm somebody with food sensitivities to common things, and that's pretty normal. So I kept working through it for several days. But the pain didn't go away, and eventually it radiated outward and into my pelvis. It started to feel like somebody set me on fire from the inside, and each progressive day was worse than the last. On a whim, I took a pregnancy test, and never before had a plus sign felt so much like a negative. At that point, I knew I had two real options. I could go to an emergency room, But at that point, an explanation of benefits would be generated and sent to my conservative father, who would likely kick me out once he saw the diagnosis. The other option was I could go to a local health center in town that operated on a sliding scale. I called the center right away. And when they heard my symptoms, they made room and encouraged me to come in right away. Once I got there, they explained that I had an ectopic pregnancy, which is where the pregnancy develops outside the uterus. I was warned that if this was not dealt with within days, I was looking at hemorrhaging to death. Thanks to their care, I was saved, and I'm able to be here with you today. Years later, I would find myself indebted to Planned Parenthood and reproductive health providers again when I had run out of my birth control pills. For me, birth control is not just a way to prevent becoming pregnant. If you have an ectopic pregnancy once, your chances of having it again are higher. Birth control keeps me safe. Additionally, as someone susceptible to hormone changes, hormonal contraceptives operates as a mood stabilizer that enables me to continue to function and contribute to society. Planned Parenthood made me a priority, was affordable, was able to supply my medication and treatment within the same day. For this and for so many other reasons, I'm grateful to them. Because of their work, I am alive today and I am thriving. I am at the top of my graduate school class. I'm looking to get my PhD, and I'm able to contribute to a better world thanks to the care that they have given me. Everyone deserves the opportunity to thrive. Everyone deserves access to complete reproductive care, including abortion. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashley. Now I'm going to bring forward Reverend Wayne Ganek.
Good morning. My name's Wayne Ganek. I'm a retired clergyman in the Presbyterian Church USA. As an ordained minister, I am proudly pro-choice. I am also very proud that my denomination as a whole is pro-choice. I currently serve as the chair of the Kentucky Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice, and in that capacity, we are very supportive of Tamari and Planned Parenthood. Y'all are great. I'm here today specifically to speak against House Bill 142. There are faith communities who, in various kinds of configurations, work with nonprofits and sometimes even directly to provide social services in communities as part of their stated mission. And those social services may utilize what HB 142 calls public agency funds, government money. When this is the case, HB 142 would prohibit a clergy person like myself from providing comprehensive care to parishioners with unplanned pregnancies. Many years ago, I was the pastor and executive director of a church and social service agency combination like I just mentioned. I remember meeting back then with a 13-year-old girl and her parents. She was pregnant, the 13-year-old girl, and I provided to her and to her parents what some people call all-option counseling. I helped them to obtain an abortion for the 13-year-old. I absolutely believe that this was the best course of action in that very tragic situation. Now, today, if House Bill 142 would be passed and that situation was to arise today, I would be in a situation where I would be putting my agency's financial security at risk in order to provide the very best pastoral, moral, and ethical care to that family. The state should have no voice whatsoever in the personal interactions between a clergy person or any other faith leader and those that are under those faith leaders' care. That is simply impermissible. And even beyond that, in a non-religiously based social service program, professional counselors and social workers, like the ones I've worked with my entire career, would be prohibited from providing what us church folks call all-option counseling to those who face what is for them, at a personal level, a very problematic pregnancy. Such a prohibition is morally and ethically unacceptable. I speak against House Bill 142, and I pray for its defeat this legislative session.
Thank you, Reverend Gnadek. I'm now going to bring forward Halpin Burke.
Hello. As a college student, I fully support a bill that would allow me to get a year's supply of birth control at once. I attend college in Connecticut, and my health care provider isn't near my school, so being able to get birth control for a whole year would bring me great peace of mind. Birth control is a basic health care for people, and by eliminating arbitrary restrictions in accessing birth control, it will ensure more people will get the care they need and can effectively use a birth control method that works best for them. Would it surprise you to know that 1 in 4 women report having missed pills because they could not get their next pack in time? Birth control gave me the freedom to take control of my own life, and that's a freedom that I don't take for granted. Being able to have a prescription for 12 months of birth control would help in the simplest of ways. I can take back my time and not have to worry about refilling a prescription or picking it up at the pharmacy. I can focus on things that matter, like my grades, instead of taking a trip to the doctor's office. Being able to pick up my birth control all at once would allow me to know that I am protected long-term, no matter what other unpredictable events should arise in my life. Leading medical authorities, including the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, agree on the benefits of comprehensive birth control access and recommend that patients have access to a full range of FDA-approved contraceptives. 19 of states and the District of Columbia have already enacted policies increasing the quantity of contraceptive covered at one time. Why? A year's supply of birth control reduces the odds of experiencing an unintended pregnancy by 30% and the need for an abortion by 46%. Having access to birth control is a right, not a privilege, because people should have autonomy over their own bodies. This bill would ensure that people across the Commonwealth maintain the right to basic health care. Birth control is health care, and this bill would enable a greater number of people to access this basic care. I am proud to stand with Planned Parenthood on this bill.
Thank you, Halpin. And to close out the press conference, we're going to bring up Miet Abraha.
Kentucky can be better. What young people learn in school about sex and sexual health is so instrumental in their ability to make important decisions throughout their lives. Kentucky should feel responsible in ensuring their students' sexual education that is comprehensive, inclusive, non-judgmental, and most importantly, informative. Lawmakers who craft legislation designed to shame young people, mostly those belonging to marginalized identities and communities, are attempting to establish and maintain a Kentucky that fails to ensure positive health outcomes for their residents that enable them and enable us to reach our utmost potential and future success. Failing to recognize the importance of sexual education that is comprehensive and non-problematic is failing to meet the needs of the people of Kentucky. Comprehensive sex education helps to prevent sexual violence, coercion, and assault, and young people need access to sex education that includes consent and healthy relationships. Lawmakers who fail to recognize the dire need for sex education should understand that the communities that they are harming the most are those that they do not belong to. Young people of marginalized identities in Kentucky have for far too long put up with sex education not designed for them or that fails to acknowledge their experiences. This contributes to the many obstacles that we face when navigating our own health and healthcare as an institution. I can understand that parents and lawmakers fear their young loved ones becoming adults and that sex is a part of that growth. But that fear prevents young people from gaining the skills that they need for a lifetime of good health, including the ability to make decisions for themselves and be an ally to those who are different and think critically about the world. As a young, college-age Black woman, I understand that sex education as it is in Kentucky is not acceptable. We can do better, It's an issue of access and public health, and it is the state's responsibility to ensure a sexual education system designed to help young people of all identities thrive in all aspects of their sexual health and ultimately their lives. We must make comprehensive, medically and scientifically accurate and age-appropriate sex education mandatory in all public schools K through 12. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming to the press conference today. We will be a force here, like I said earlier, both for proactive legislation and defending our constitutional rights. We have an incredible support system here in Frankfort and in our voices that are going to be affected by the health outcomes of this Commonwealth. Moving forward, we plan to be here again March 19th for our rally day and for any other reason that would bring us here. So thank you again, and we'll be seeing you in the halls.